Okay, so we talked about CHIP before and the fact that we did get the federal money to keep it going, thank God. So question, why does the budget still have language that would allow you to change rates or freeze enrollment or make other programmatic changes, since it doesn't appear that you need that language anymore? That's a note. Next, we talked about concerns, excuse me, too many pieces of paper, also about the essential plan and the fact and some things that are in the budget, but maybe we don't need because maybe the feds won't do it, but it does appear that the administration in Washington has cut the cost-sharing reduction money and that's a significant amount of the funding we spent for the essential health plan, which impacts, I think, 700,000 people in New York State. So I'm very concerned about how we make sure that we are continuing the essential health plan and would also like to know, are you planning, again, reducing the payments, reducing eligibility, changing something else about the program, since it does appear, my notes show that we lose up to $1 billion from the federal government for that program. So I'm curious how we're going to fill in the gaps. A number of people talked about the concerns for primary care, and you talked about rural care shortages. If we're so focused on expanding primary care and pediatric care, why are we reducing Medicaid funding for these programs, particularly for pediatricians and other patient-centered primary care programs? It doesn't seem like it's the time to reduce Medicaid formula payments for exactly the kind of health care we're talking about having a very real need and goal to expand. See, he takes notes very fast. I'm saying that. Thank you. No ink? Stop that. Yes, there's ink. There's ink, right?
Tell me. Yes, there is. There's ink. I promise.
Thank you. We had a series of questions around the governor's first 1,000 days of life program, and I'm a big supporter of expanding these programs. But I'm very disturbed that when you look in the budget, he's actually cutting 20% out of the funds out of maternal and child health care programs, even though there's all this new commitment. And specifically, he talked a bit about the importance of expanding health care for maternal depression, an issue that I have worked on for quite a few years now. So I'm curious how the governor is going to implement his expanded programs for maternal depression, matching providers with mental health specialists once a woman's been diagnosed, when we're actually cutting the funds that are available, you know, in the pot of money that you cover maternal depression and maternal mortality, you're cutting the funds, and it seems to me to be pretty counterproductive. Then, oh good, I'm just running along. So there's a real concern that's been raised. There's lots of issues in MLTC rates that were raised, but one that I don't think I heard yet was the concern that for the most acute patients, there's already been a serious question about rate adequacy and that you're going to be changing the scoring in some way that make it even harder for people to be found eligible for care. The acuity score is the term that I was told, that there would be an increase in acuity score required to get access to home care services. So if we're already hearing that people who have the most severe need are actually not always able to get the care they need, wouldn't increasing the acuity score be an added problem as opposed to some kind of solution for us at this time? And in my 43 seconds that's left, I raised with Dr. Zucker the other day, so I'm just raising it again so he can follow up with me, concern around the decision to go sole source for Alzheimer's and dementia care services in the state, including continuing a contract to an out-of-state hotline, which doesn't actually provide direct services to people in New York, and some people are not clear that if you're a national hotline, you even know where you might find the right place to refer people to throughout the 62 counties of New York. And I've used my 5 minutes. So.
All right.
You want them to get back to me later? How do you want to handle this, Lee?
How about a short
speed round? Speed,
fine, we'll
do
that.
Short speed round.
Speed round on CHIP. Language was put in there because of the potential loss of federal funds. Certainly something to be re-explored since that threat is no longer there. CSR in the essential plan, big impact on New York State. It was 25% of the funding that goes into a program that serves over 700,000 New Yorkers. It was a big thing we had to solve for in this budget. Good news is that the budget, as proposed, doesn't take away health care from anybody, doesn't increase anyone's cost sharing. We're able to basically find sufficient savings overall in the program so that there's no impact on New Yorkers because of the Trump administration's decision to end CSRs. That said, the Attorney General's launching, has along with the state of Minnesota, launched litigation on that particular issue. PCMH funding cap, it's a budgetary initiative, very fast growing program. Significant funding went into those primary care practices to achieve a PCMH level from the district program. So we felt that it was a cap that was reasonable and appropriate, but understand the concern about it. But still, we're gonna spend north of $100 million in supplemental payments to practices that meet those national standards. The last one I have before I turn to Dr. Zucker is MLTC, the change in the eligibility from 5 to 9. Actually, the reasoning for that is to focus the program on individuals who have the most needs. It's a very high touch, very expensive care management program. And so the idea is that the individuals with acuity scores below 9 will be able to access services in fee-for-service. We already have many people that receive short-term home and community-based services through fee-for-service, so it just slightly increases the number of people that would be getting it through that door, fee-for-service, as opposed to through managed long-term care. I can't remember off the top of my head the number of individuals affected, but it's relatively small, and we grandfather in anyone who currently is in the program.
Regarding the Alzheimer's issue, that contract actually is with the New York State Alzheimer's Coalition, which is based in New York. It's actually headquartered here in Albany, so the contract won't leave New York State. It stays within the state on that issue. And on the other issue regarding the 20% cut, this is where we look at other, we're working with the Office of Mental Health, and Dr. Sullivan and I have looked at how can we address some of these issues. It ties more into the whole issue of advanced primary care, where we look at providing primary care and behavioral health together, and I think there's a way by doing that to not end up that 20% cut won't be impacted as much.
We don't necessarily agree on all those answers, but thank you for giving it a good shot.